It's Orson Welles.
Of course it is.
I think it's time we talked.
What is it the writer says? Tell the story you know.
First of all, congratulations on Mank. I'm so excited for everybody to be able to see it. Obviously, Fincher's just one of the best, right? So I think it's just default reaction to be excited for everything. And then, of course, when it is as good as it is, it's just that much better. So I want to first talk about, you have a pretty decorated history in theater, doing a lot of Shakespeare. I'm curious if the transition into film was something that felt natural to you, or if there was some specific event or project that kind of led you to make the switch.
Yeah, I mean, it felt natural insofar as that, you know, they're in the same family of creative expression, but I mean, they're very different disciplines, and I think it's fair to say that for the first few years after I left drama school, approximately a billion years ago, I was more comfortable on stage than I was on screen, because that was the basis of our training. You know, it was a very stage-based training, as most British drama schools at least were until the last couple of years, really. It took them a little while to catch up with the industry, really. I mean, I was most comfortable. I felt like even at 21, 22, I could come out, go on stage or into a rehearsal room and, you know, make a fist of anything, have a go at anything, and, you know, chuck stuff at the wall and see what would stick, because I was that kind of animal, and I didn't have as much experience on screen. And so when I was in front of a camera, I was just a bit more, a bit less confident than I would have been in a rehearsal room. So that's why my first few years of my career were mainly stage. But then in terms of moving on, I don't really see it as that, because I'd go back and work in the theatre the first opportunity I would get, I mean, as soon as they reopened. But I think it probably took for me to get really comfortable. I'd done a few films and a few telly jobs, but for me to get really, really like comfortable in my own skin was the 3 years I did on Victoria, probably. Which you guys had on PBS over there, didn't you? A masterpiece, but we had on ITV here, and to have a long running character arc was fab, and also it gave me the opportunity to move on from trying to work out who my character was, because you know you have the luxury of a long arc, and to make sure that I could make my craft as relaxed and comfortable as possible. Not that, you know, you're just using the job as a training ground, but I think you do learn something on every job, and you, it's inevitable that if you spend 3 years with something, you're gonna come away more comfortable in it, hopefully. And I certainly did, and it was a lovely job for all sorts of reasons, but I certainly did feel about as at ease in front of the camera as I was on stage by the time I ended that job.
That's great to hear. I think the transition from stage to screen, or sometimes people go in reverse, can already be difficult enough. I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit further on, they're two very different things. You know, obviously live theater, you get one take, you get your performance. You don't get the chance to go back and correct it. And additionally, depending on the project that you're working on, you sometimes get, you know, 2 months, 6 weeks with the material. Yeah. You're really learning your character in and out. On something either television or film, it's a longer process overall, but I personally don't feel that you necessarily get the same amount of time to kind of do the character work.
And so I agree.
Yeah, so on a project like Mank too, where your role is not necessarily as broad as something like Shakespeare, can you just talk about your experience on, you know, kind of having to narrow down Irving and then give the most to him with the scenes you had?
Yeah, so I well, what we did have, which was really lucky, and I think, well, and I know it's relatively rare, but with someone like David, is possible, is we had rehearsal. We did have about 3 weeks of rehearsal, 3.5 weeks of rehearsal, just at his office in LA, sitting around his desk in his conference room, just reading and talking and talking and talking, and he'd tweak bits of the script with Eric Roth, and he would, you know, tell anecdotes that were pertinent or didn't seem relevant, but then you'd go, oh, okay, now I have some sort of, you know, he'd actually be talking about Alien 3, but then you'd go, oh, actually, he's talking about the financing of films with oversight from the studios and the bosses interfering X, Y, and Z. And so you go, actually, it is relevant to what we're working on. So we did, it was, although it isn't like a theatre rehearsal room, it's a bit like the early weeks in a rehearsal room where you sit round and just read and talk and read and talk and find out the dynamic between the characters. So that was brilliant, and also takes a lot of the terror of the first day away, which I think no matter what the scale of the job is, and this one is, you know, is relatively high level. I think the first day of anything is kind of terrifying, especially if you're jet lagged and, you know, in black and white. So to have a few weeks of just digging into it was great. And plus, he's so no nonsense. You just walk in and he's like, hey, how you doing? Let's go. Like, you know, you ready to work? Let's go. You're like, I guess I am. Let's go. Let's do it. So it was a case of sort of chiseling away at stuff and talking things through, and also saying, right, what's important for us to get across in this film, in these scenes, because it's not necessary, while you obviously want to pay tribute to or be truthful to the historical Irving, the real Irving, it was also important for us to remember that this is a film that you very much see through Mank's eyes. You know, it's a vision of the world, of Hollywood, of politics, through the eyes of the man who's writing a film. It's not necessarily a documentary objective truth. It's very subjective. So, you know, Irving in the film is probably more cold and calculating and borderline cruel than he was in real life. Although he was, of course, massively manipulative and incredibly right wing and all manner of things. We needed to sort of focus on elements of him that served Mank's memories. And David would talk about stuff like, you know, he wanted a sort of symmetrical energy. We were talking about, you know, a sort of laser focus, like he's sort of in the middle of a seesaw, you know, and he's the fulcrum point that everything's around him, and he's just so that Mank's sort of wildness and madness would sort of bounce off him and be the yang to his yin, whatever you want to, you know, the two sides of a similar coin. But polished very differently.
Hello, everyone.
Make yourself to home, Mr. Mankiewicz, or shall I call you Herman?
Please, call me Mank.
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 This is Herman Mankiewicz, but we're to call him Mank.
Mankiewicz. Herman Mankiewicz, New York playwright and drama critic turned humble screenwriter, Mr. Hearst.
This is a business where the buyer gets nothing for his money but a memory. What he bought still belongs to the man who sold it. That's the real magic of the movies.
Thunder, lightning, blood, fire, religion.
Help! Someone save me!
All in one film.
That's director proof.
That's why I always want Mank around.
No, that's fantastic to think about, because ignorantly, I didn't realize how important Irving was until I was doing research on him, and he's referred to as like the boy wonder of Hollywood.
Yeah, man.
He only lived.
I don't think it's ignorant of you at all, because I think that's one of the things that made me so fascinated by him, because I'd heard the name, I'd heard his name, I'd been in the Thalberg building at Sony, I've heard of the Thalberg Award that the Academy give out, but I hadn't taken the time to wonder about him. And then as soon as I started reading about him, when there was this sliver of a possibility that I might be playing him, I sort of was astonished at how important he was without his name being everywhere. And that was a choice that he made. You know, he never had his name on a film. They put his name on one film, and that was when he died. But he produced 400 of them in the short time that he was alive, the painfully short time he was alive. And he said, well, I would say famously, but you know, him being him, not famously, he said notably, that credit you give yourself isn't worth having. Which is a good thing to sort of a good hook to hang yourself on when you're thinking about a character. But yeah, he was incredibly important, and one of the characters that found power in being invisible. And you know, he could pull the strings behind the scenes, but he didn't want his name on it for all sorts of reasons, some of which are included in when he essentially made fake news, which you see in the film. And he had the kit to do it. He had the capacity. He had the drive. He had his own set of morals, and he also had the ability to hide himself. Hide his name from it. So yeah, he was absolutely the boy wonder, and incredibly well respected and known in that world. And indeed, when he died, all of Hollywood shut down, and there were 7,000 people at his funeral or something mad like that. But to Joe Public, he's unknown,
which is wild to me. And so I was curious, as I was researching him, and like, he turned down producing Gone with the Wind, which is just something because he was too busy, had done too many.
Didn't fancy it. He also didn't think that that the talkies were going to take off. He really didn't like the idea. It took him a long time to come round to. He just thought that, well, he was like, they'll be okay. It's okay that we have talking movies, but they're not going to replace silent movies. He was like, just as we still have portraits and we still have photographs, just because we've got moving pictures doesn't mean we're going to stop doing them. He got that one wrong. But then again, you know, he's allowed to. He produced Ben-Hur when he was 23 and set up MGM when he was 23. You know, it's, I think he had pretty good instincts on the whole.
Yeah, he gets a bit of a pass. So as an actor, when you're doing your research and you're preparing in that way, and there's such a wide catalog to pull from, how do you kind of compartmentalize what is important to know about him and kind of retain close to your chest about him during the scenes that you have, especially because the scenes that you have in contrast with, you know, Mank are very important. You know, the dialogue exchange between them in the offices, even that scene where you're trying to press for the donation, those are small little bubbles, but are very important to the course of the story. So how do you kind of, you know, ascertain what you really need to laser in on?
Well, I think it's a really good question, because it's tempting to just try and sort of carry the whole of the character in with you, isn't it? Like, you know, I've done all this work and here it all is. I think the bit of the iceberg under the sea is all the work that you do in terms of finding out who he is, you know, what he ate for breakfast, you know, like that's the bit you do on your own time, and that's all in there. And then you've got to trust that it's in there, trust yourself and relax. And for me, I just wanted to work out the things that were sort of, boil it down to really important things for him, which were that he had unshakable faith in his beliefs, and that no one's going to knock him off that. And crucially for me, which is only really alluded to, but the thought that any week could be his last. That was what I wanted to take into it, you know, all the time. And then my relationship with Mank, which is, you know, David and I were trying to find a sort of, well, we weren't trying to find a line to think about, but, you know, we just kept thinking, like, why does he bother with Mank? Why do I bother with you? And there's all sorts of answers. And one of them is basically, you know, if you can get half an hour's work out of him before he's drunk by 11 a.m. then that half hour might be genius. The Mank, do you know the Wizard of Oz story with Mank, that he couldn't be bothered to do it. He just get himself fired off everything, and he didn't want to do the job. He thought it was going to be rubbish, and one morning, just before he started drinking, he said, should start in black and white, go color, end in black and white. And then he was like, I can't bother to do the rest of the film, fire me. So he just came up with so Thalberg's always looking for that in Mank. So there's those kind of three things for me. It was that, you know, I believe what I believe, and I'm going to try and make it happen. I am a ticking time bomb. You know, I don't have the luxury of time that other people have. Wasting time is for other people. and it's a luxury that other people can afford and I can't because I'm very frail. And also just seeing the sort of the what value is in everyone around me. What can I get from people? What can they do for me? What do I need from them? And how can I get them to do it for me? So it was a case of just boiling it down, as you say, and knowing that actually, much as I might want it to be, it's not a film called Irving. You know, it's like that joke in Shakespeare in Love where the guy's trying to chat someone up and he goes, have you seen Romeo and Juliet? And they go, no, what's it about? And he goes, oh yeah. So there's this nurse, you know, just it's really tempting to tell yourself or tell everyone else that the film's about you, but we're all cogs in his journey really in this film, and that's stated I think really well by his brother Joe Mankiewicz that Tom Pelfrey plays, and I think it's amazing when he says, you know, I'm here on behalf of the minor characters, I'm here on behalf of the supporting cast. He says to him, you know, we're not all the leading man in your life, Mank, you know, and some of us drift in and out, and we've got to have our message along the way. Sorry, that was a bit of a burbly answer to your very, very clear question.
No, that's perfect. That's exactly the kind of answers that we hope for. So I appreciate it. but that sounds like you had, so I love as an actor when you find like a character that is just so delicious to dive into, like there's so much to sink your teeth into. Can you talk a little bit about how you got involved in the process, if you had like a formal audition process to get in the film?
And in the film, yeah. I mean, my raging ego would love to say that Fincher texted me and said, how about this? And I was like, I'll call you back in a few weeks, mate. I'm not sure. But in reality, it was like any other job to start with, in that I got, you know, I got sent the tape through my amazing agents in the States. In fact, I got sent, I was asked to tape for my part and for Sam Troughton's part, John Houseman. Did it, I thought not much more of it other than that I, you know, wanted to do a good job because of the material and it being David. And then thought no more of it and went to a music festival to get drunk in a field and got a phone call saying, he really likes your Thalberg tape. And I was like, well, actually, has he seen the other one? Because the other one was much better. so can you know, he's going to email you directly 16 odd pages. Can you record them for him? So I sobered up, didn't drink that night, went home, read a lot about Thalberg on the way home, did another tape, which I guess would be sort of the equivalent of a recall, but funny because it was just more material. And then we had a Zoom, which was my first ever Zoom. I'd never heard of Zoom. I was told to download it and failed to buy shares in it. And we talked for an hour or so about it while I sort of sat in this chair going, sweating and trying not to fuck it up. And then he was just very nice at the end of the call, but I couldn't quite read what he was talking about. So we hung up and I lay on the floor going, I have a headache, being an actor is hard. And then I got a text in the middle of the night that night saying he's gone for it. So it was pretty, you know, it would have been a standard audition process, except the fact that it's him and he really trusts his instincts. So there wasn't actually much waiting around between the start of the process and the finding out that I'd got it. And then, of course, you know, you've got to make sure you get your visa, make sure you get into the country, make sure, you know, your bag doesn't get lost at the airport, which it did. So yeah, he really, it's a real vote of confidence in you, the artist, when somebody, especially of his caliber, goes, you do your work, and he goes, yeah, sure. That's, you know, that fits into the jigsaw that I'm trying to put together. That's what I want. Rather than having to just sit around with him going, you know, I 60% like him, but 40% I'm not sure about, and what if he's got, his eyebrows are too stupid or X, Y, Z. And he just goes for it. And that's very much him. You know, he when he sees what he, when it sort of answers a question that he's asking, he goes for it.
That's amazing. I have, like, my one claim to fame is that I had auditioned for Mindhunter years ago.
Did you?
And it was,
oh,
it
I
was
love
like
Mindhunter.
It was like the one big audition I had, and I was not told by my agent for a while that it was him doing it, and then she just kind of casually drops his name, and I was like, you tell me that after I submitted my tape. Yeah. But I got a callback or two, but then it was just terrifying because you're then aware that it's like moving up in the ranks, and you're like, at some
point, oh yeah, of course, and the pressure goes on.
Yeah, it's horrendous. So I slightly related, like a much smaller
scale. Oh no, I hear you. I mean, like, when I know I was taking the piss out of myself when I said I lay on the floor and when I was not being an actor, what I was really thinking was kind of what you're saying, that like, this is gonna hurt when I don't get it,
right?
Because I can sort of feel it now. I can see it and smell it, and so you just, yeah, of course, you have to, as an actor, you have to care, and you have to, it's a sort of, you're doing a double think thing, because you have to, on the one hand, you have to really care, and you have to imagine yourself turning up at work doing that job, otherwise you're not going to commit to it, and what's the point? But on the other hand, you also have to not think that it's yours, because it's not real until it's real. And so you've got to do this double thing of going, I passionately care and see myself walking onto set, and I can do this and I will deliver it. And on the other hand, you go, if it's not mine, it's not mine.
Right.
And that is so hard to balance. And I imagine that feeling never goes away.
No, it does not. So two more questions as we wrap up here, because I don't want to take up too much of your time.
Oh, I've got nothing to do for the rest of my life, so keep going.
Kind of going back to, you know, the difference between theater and film.
Mm.
Shakespeare, for me, growing up in the theater, was like, I wanted to stay away from it. It was so scary to me and so intimidating. And I just think it is the most important material that an actor can start working with. I want to know your experience doing Shakespeare, transitioning to working with Fincher, who is notorious for doing sometimes upward of like 100 takes on
scenes.
What is your headspace like making that transition? And did you have to kind of convert your natural approach as an actor?
I think it's a really smart question, because I think one feeds into the other more than you might expect, and I have no idea whether that was in his head when he cast quite a lot of thesps. There's a lot of, you know, a lot of this cast have worked a lot on stage, and there's a lot of Brits, and you know, I was a theatre animal in the background. Tom Burke, absolutely the same. Sam Troughton, absolutely the same. Tuppence, the same. Charles Dance works in the theatre, heaps and heaps and heaps. So there's a lot of theatre background in it. And I don't know whether he chose that because it's, whether he consciously chose it or whether he chose it because of the material. You know, that's that time when the industry was shifting from vaudeville and theatre to film, or whether it was just coincidence. And he liked our fruity voices, I don't know. But I think to answer your sort of Shakespeare question, I think that whatever you do, whatever other work you do, can only be improved by getting your brain around text like Shakespeare. Because even if you don't do Shakespeare anymore, or you never do it professionally, it's like, even at its most boring, it's a workout, but I don't think it's boring at all. You know, even at its most fundamental, getting your head around that complexity of thought and length of thought and length of text makes you more able to tackle everything, I think. And if I ever got to a point where I was important enough for anybody to ask me what advice I would give to a young actor, I would say learn Hamlet. Like, even if you never have any intention of ever doing it, learn it, or learn the soliloquies at the very least, because they strengthen your brain. Like, your imagination's a muscle, and your brain has all sorts of expansion capacity. And when I did that and learnt it all, I felt just better equipped at everything in life. I was more able to think quickly. I was more able to tackle difficult thoughts in work and life more quickly. I was able to, I wasn't as scared of, you know, if you can learn that, then you can learn anything. So I think it, God, this is such a good question, because I can now carry on with my pretentious answer of saying that the stamina you get from working on text like that is invaluable for a set like Fincher's, because so much of working with him is about minuscule changes, minuscule adjustments over and over and over again. You know, I think our record on this was only 70 something takes, 74, 75 takes. And that was for the scene where Mank and Louis B. Mayer, Arliss, were the sort of walking and talking one, the sort of West Wing style one as they're walking through MGM. They did that 70 something times. And I once asked David if we were going to hit his record, and he swore at me and said, my record's 108. But I think, you know, you a lot of the discipline on his sets is about maintaining focus and conserving energy and spending your energy in the right way. And I think that's the kind of thing that you can get fitter at by doing really complex texts like Shakespeare. Because if you come in the first 5 minutes of a 3.5 hour play screaming your head off, all guns blazing, you've got nowhere to go, and you're liable to burn out before act two or three. Likewise, if you do your first take and then like go and run around in circles, have five coffees, and like, you know, do a handstand and tell 15 jokes to everyone on set, you're going to be tired by the time it comes around to take 50 something. So I working on David's set, you know, you finish a day at work knackered, you're really tired, but the kind of tired that isn't just, you know, brain dead tired. It's the kind of tired like you've done a really long run, or you know, played a game of sport. You know, you're tired but you're fitter, and I certainly felt like at the end of every day I was just a smidge better at acting than I was at the start. Because you learn to kind of drop the crap, you know, just cut the pare away the clutter. Don't use what you don't need. Because if you've got all this extraneous stuff going on, again, by like take 40, 50, it's going to be all over the place. It's like, you know, trying to color something in. And if you've gone out the lines a few times, like, I've got to go out the lines again. And then it's wild. And I've gone off track with the question you asked, but I to try and sum it up, I think the discipline you get from working with those great texts is perfect for a job like working with Fincher, because you're ready to pace yourself and to sort of look a few acts ahead in the day, rather than just do your bit and turn your brain off. Because if you do that, you'll have a miserable time on his sets. I think if you treat hard work like it's something to be resented, then you're going to be really grumpy on a Fincher set. But if, like me, you're a massive nerd and you like, you want to work hard, then you have a great time. I had a great time.
Yeah. How many days did you spend on the set? Because it wasn't even a four-month shoot, if I understand.
How many days did I spend? I couldn't tell you, because we did reshoots as well. Okay. So it was 2.5 weeks rehearsal. Then I was out there for all of November and about 6 days into December. And then I did another couple of weeks in January, and then another couple of weeks in February. So I don't know how many days on set it would have been, but
so you were there for a majority of the time.
Yeah, I was there in and around for the majority of the time. I probably did like 25 days on set, 20, 25. Because some of those long scenes took a long time. You know, the in the sort of the party, it's a very City Downy party, but the party scene at Hurst Castle where we're talking politics, that took about 5 days, 6 days. As did the scenes where we're shooting outside at Hurst Castle, the sort of where Marion Davis is tied to the stake, you know, with the Indians and the cowboys. That took about 5 days, and then we reshot the whole thing. We shot that in. We totally, that was rewritten and reshot. So I don't have a succinct answer, but I was there enough to feel a big part of it, and it was it's a sort of ensemble-y film. So we were like us Brits knocking about together. Me Tuppence and Sam Troughton spent quite a lot of time together in bars in LA.
I hear you're hunting dangerous game.
God bless William Randolph Hearst.
Ready and willing to hunt the great white whale?
Just call me Ahab.
Do come in.
At this rate, you will never finish.
You said 90 days. Well, said 60. I'm doing the best I can.
I've put up with your suicidal drinking, your compulsive gambling, your silly platonic affairs. You owe me, Herman.
Who do you think you are? You're nothing but a court jester.
And then as we wrap up here with my final question, I think that leads for a great segue. Obviously, you know, as actors, we always assume that the project we're working on is going to prepare us for the next project and so on and so forth. And I think in particular, when we have the privilege to work with a character such as Irving, I think they stick with us for a while. Mm. Personally, I'm an actor as well. I always find it very hard to separate myself from characters. I was Anne Frank in college, and that was just a whole...
good luck getting rid of that, yeah.
Separate mental thing. So I'm curious... What are you taking?
I was the same when I played Jesus, by the way.
a little heavy.
Couldn't shake it off.
Couldn't do it. What did you take away from Irving? Like, what did he teach you that is going to stay with you and either make you, you know, a better man, a better actor? And what are you taking away from Mank that is preparing you for your next project? No pressure.
no pressure. Okay, well, I think... You don't have to like everything about your character. It's really tempting to, because I, on many levels, I sort of fell in love with Irving and this sort of untold history around him. But there's huge sides of him that I absolutely don't align with. I don't align with his politics whatsoever, and various other things. But I intense admiration for him and compassion for him. I think. One of the things I take away is what I mentioned to you earlier about the luxury of time. I'm quite a terrible time waster, and it's something that I have never liked about myself. Every I'm not very good at New Year's resolutions, but I think every year since I was about 18, I've made the resolution to waste less time. And here I am thinking, I'm 32 now, I should probably get started with my life. He died when he was 37, and he didn't wait around. Now I think to it'd be unrealistic to say I'm going to achieve anything like that, because it's a totally different set of circumstances, different world, and I don't have that hanging over me. But, you know, equally, touch wood, I won't, but any of us could be hit by a bus tomorrow or drop dead, you know. And so one of the things I took away is to go for it, and try to fill your days. And that's been really hard this year, as it has been for loads of us, because time has done two things. It's stood still, and it's raced. Like, somehow it's nearly the end of the year, and the last thing I remember, it was about 2013. So I don't know what's happened to time, but it's been this year, I think. You know, we can give ourselves a free pass, because it's okay to just survive, and nailing life can come once we finish surviving. But I would certainly take away that from him. As I said before, it's one of the things that I was thinking about all the time with him, that the sort of the clock is ticking, and whether you let that oppress you or inspire you is up to you. And he chose to let it inspire him, and I want to choose that myself, and try to enjoy the ride a little bit. What does the experience of working on the film, what did I take from that? Working hard is so fun. It is so fun, and it's easy to forget when you're out of work. Or because you know, you can just think, I just want one day of this or whatever, or I want to get the job and then it'll all be easy. You know, that's when you get the jobs, when it really starts. So I would take away that working hard is incredibly fun, and there's very little point in doing anything other than giving it your all. But again, on the flip side of that, I was painfully aware that not every job I do is going to be, I'm not going to have the luxury of a million takes. You know, there's going to be plenty of jobs where if you say mostly the right words and, you know, don't look directly into the camera, they'll move on. You know, they'll shoot the rehearsal and that'll be fine. So I've made sure that I'm aware that that is not the norm, but that I want to kind of bring the level of hard work from that job to my other work, and like the crew had as well. They were just absolutely phenomenal, that crew. And you had another part to the question. What was it?
No, that was it.
Oh, what? Yeah. What am I going to do with the rest of my life? No idea.
Well, I
talk about hope for the best, try and enjoy the ride.
Oh, that's all of us. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for such thoughtful answers, Mr. Kingsley. I definitely don't feel like I had time wasted with you this morning. This was a pleasure, and I cannot wait for everybody to see you in Mank.
It was really lovely. Thank you, mate. I really, really appreciate talking to you.
Thank you. Take care.
Thanks, pal. Take care.
What I want to know is what you think of it.
It's a bit of a jumble, a collection of fragments that leap around in time like Mexican jumping beans.
Welcome to my mind, old sock.
Him, I get. But what did Marion ever do to deserve
it's
this?
It's not her. Not all characters are headliners. Some are secondary.
You pick a fight with Willie, you are finished. Mayor can't save you. Nobody can, especially the boy genius from New York.
I removed any distraction, eliminated every excuse. Your family, your cronies, liquor. I gave you a second chance.
You cannot capture a man's entire life in 2 hours. All you can hope is to leave the impression of what?
Why Hurst? Outside his own blonde Betty Boop, you're always his favorite dinner partner.
Are you familiar with the parable of the organ grinder's monkey?